Good morning. If everybody would come in and we'll get started. This beautiful morning. It's good to see everybody here. It's nice to have our family Spanish with us today. That's an added blessing. A couple announcements. Again, the women's ministries, it's in your bulletin for March 30th here at the Fellowship Hall. And if you remember the midweek service here at the church, it's been very, very well attended. So if you want a blessing during the middle of the week, come to that. And the next Sabbath is the is communion next Sabbath. So prepare yourself this week for that. And if you, for those that are visiting or need something, if you're not on the church email list, you fill this out and put it in with the offering as it goes by. If you need prayer or special prayer, anything like that, if you're new and need something from the pastor or something like that, fill it out and put it in the offering basket as it goes by. Thanks.
Test 1, 2. Good morning. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Buenos dias. Feliz sábado a todos. We are happy to be here this morning with you to praise our Lord. Some of you might know us as Grecia's worship group or the Hispanic worship group, but we actually have a name. We actually started this music ministry at the beginning of this year. And you want to know the name? All right. We are called Redeemed. That is the name of our music ministry, Redeemed. So in the future reference, Redeemed, you know who we are. All right. So this morning, we're going to worship all together. We're not here to sing a special song. We're not here to show off our voices. We are here to invite all of you to worship the Lord together with us. Because that's why we're here, right? We're here to worship the Lord. So I'm going to invite everybody to stand up and sing with us this first song that is called 10,000 Reasons. It should be a familiar song for all of you.
It's a new day dawning. Mighty rock in a weary land.
Her song service with what a beautiful name it is, and that name is Jesus.
Thank you.
threading needle as far as possible. Dear Father, worthy is your name, King above kings, name above all names. So we thank you for looking down on us and calling us your children. What a something we can't hardly comprehend. We thank you for this opportunity, for this Sabbath, to come before your throne and worship with your people. Be with each one that came through these doors today. May you receive a blessing. Those that are watching online, may they receive a blessing also. We want to pray for those today that are in the hospital, in the prayer box here, that nobody knows about but you. There's a lot of requests, especially now in the times that we're in, that there's a lot of requests that are being asked. To be what I will, answer them. Draw close to each one that needs being close to today, mental, physical, whatever, financial. If it be thy will, answer these according to your will. Be with us this coming week. Keep us safe. We can come back next week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm so excited to be here in this baptistry with him. He has made a decision to recommit his life to Jesus, and something amazing has happened in his life to him and his wife, Crystal. They just had a brand new baby named Luke. And so I've asked Damien if he'd share just briefly his testimony right now.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. So as Pastor Dave just said, me and my beautiful wife, we have a brand new beautiful son, Luke Thomas, and he's why I'm here today. My family is the reason why I'm here today. So actually this month, 9 years ago, my wife brought me into this church, and I was a very alcoholic. 4-day weekends, I was in the Army. Experienced combat multiple occasions, lost friends to combat, and lost a lot more friends to the battle here due to suicide. And on multiple occasions, I've tried taking that same fate. Mm-hmm. I've put my gun in my mouth, and I've had multiple times where I just didn't want to be here. And my wife is the one that always kept me relatively grounded. And I remember the first time she brought me into this church, I never had an issue with believing in God, but I had a very big issue in believing that he cared. Mm. And the level of anger and rage that filled me, it just never really went away. And I remember sitting in the back pews, and I just remember thinking, like, man, I'm supposed to be this hardcore infantryman. I've seen combat. I've done all this. And I'm sitting here in the back crying like a little girl. I was like, what is wrong with me? So I got baptized, and I wanted to commit myself to God, and I felt his love for the first time. And honestly, his love at some point scared me. Hmm. I felt I wasn't deserving, and so I went back to being angry. I went back to being suicidal, turned to alcohol again, and I used that anger and that rage to fuel my business, to keep me focused in my business. And I saw levels of success that I personally never thought I'd see. And it didn't make me happy. And 2 weeks ago when my son was born, after everybody left and all the dust settled, it was just, my wife was asleep and Luke was sitting in my arms, and I just, for the first time in a long time, I actually tried to have a conversation with God, and I felt I got an answer. Mm. I asked him, I didn't want to live and lead my son with rage and anger. I wanted peace, I wanted love, I wanted to breathe life into him. And it hit me like this wave, and it was just this overwhelming calm and peace that hit me. And God's the reason why I'm here getting rebaptized, because he's the one that told me to be here.
Amen.
He told me to lead my life and lead my family's life through him, and I want to lead my business and everything that I do in life through him, and that's why I'm here.
Amen. Damien, you heard the voice of God. And you didn't hesitate. And you know, we spent some time at Starbucks together in your home, and I'm so proud of you for following your commitment to listening to the voice of God. And I'd like to invite Crystal and Luke, if you'd stand at this time. Crystal and Luke, where are you at? And close family and friends, if you're here, would you just, in recognition of this moment, here's Crystal and Luke, to stand for Damien. We are so proud of you for making this decision today. Damien, because you love the Lord with all of your heart and your soul and your mind, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I just want to take this moment to say that if anyone here has been hearing and listening to the voice of God and you've been putting it off, don't put it off any longer. I'd love to talk to you. This is a moment you'll never regret. You'll never have a better opportunity, and don't wait for it. And I just love to just chat with you. There's no rush, but we just want to make certain you don't put off that voice of God speaking to you. Damien followed that voice. And we're so grateful for that. Let's praise the Lord once more for the decision that Damien made. Amen. Amen.
Amen. It's such a nice thing to happen today. Today's offerings for the conference advance, and that's kind of confusing, but it goes for stuff that happens in the conference, like up at Glacier View and stuff like that that happened. You know, Glacier View is quite the facility. You know, we've been up there. I never got to go as a kid because I had to work. I didn't get to go to camp. but you know, with Jonathan Kelly up there, we've been up there a few times up there, and it's a great facility, and that's just one of the things that offering today goes for. So if you'd mark that or mark the different things on your tithe envelope for the different ministries in the church, you can put that in it. And remember, if you need this, get this filled out, drop it in the basket as it goes by. Deacons, please stand. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to give back just a small portion of the many blessings you bless us with every day. Take this money and multiply it to do thy will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Kids, it's your time. And don't forget the routine. Go do all the aisles. Watch for people handing out money for our grade school, for SAA. Don't miss any. Boy, even Amari's coming up. All right. Sweet, I like them. All right, I think we're almost there. Oh, even Araya's got some money here to put in. Woo! This box looks good, folks. Ceci and Brian, oh man. Okay, I've got some more helpers today, and we're going to review from last time. It's not just for the kids, it's for all of us, okay? Wow, we have got a good group here. All right, we're going to say this text, Jeremiah 9, 23 and part of 24, and I've got some visuals up here that are going to help me. Everybody ready? Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man glory in his might, nor let the rich man glory in his riches. But let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me. One more time. And maybe this will be in your brain forever. That'd be great. Okay. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man glory in his might. Nor let the rich man glory in his riches. But let him who glory in this, that he understands and knows me. All right. Thank you, helpers. You can put your stuff down here. All right. I did something I have not done here. Last week, I did a continued story. Anybody here from last week that remembers where we were when we left off? Where was Joe? You don't remember? Well, maybe you weren't here. Well, let me catch you up a little bit. Oh, where was he? Nope. Joe wanted to be a sailor so bad. He was only 15 years old, remember? And he got a job on the Fanny, which was a boat, a big boat. In fact, it was a boat that looked similar to that one, okay? And Joe was asked to go up to the top to look for some other boats, and he said, all's clear, but when he started coming down, what happened? He slipped on the rope, and he fell into the water. Now, there was something else in that water that I told you about last week. What was it? A shark. A great white shark. And, you know, Joe came up and he was sputtering. A great white shark, that's right. He was sputtering, but he came to the surface and, oh no, he saw the boat out of reach. He couldn't reach the boat. And he thought, oh no. And right away, one of his buddies, a sailor, grabbed a rope, threw it out as hard as he could throw it, just hoping that Joe would grab it. And he did. He grabbed onto the rope, and all the sailors pulled Joe up onto the, you know, the ship. And oh my goodness, he was so glad to be on the ship. But what about the shark? He had actually forgotten about the shark. He was trying to save his life, and he'd forgotten about the shark. And one of the sailors went on the other side of the boat and looked over, and guess what was there? The great white shark just swimming alongside the boat. And all the sailors, they scratched their head and they said, wait a minute, those white sharks, if something falls in the water, they're on it. How come that shark didn't eat Joe? And the first mate, Mr. Aldrich, said, only God knows. Boys, only God knows. And they all agreed. Now, you would think that Joe would give up sailing after that incident, but not Joe. Mm-mm. In 3 weeks, he was out on the Fanny again for another voyage. And, you know, he sailed for a couple years, and one time, the boat was out there. And it's quite a story. I can't go into detail. But they were over by England and over by Europe with their boat. And the British, well, some of the British, they captured Joe and his buddy, Bilbo. And they said, you come with us. And they said, okay. And don't try and escape. And they said, well, okay. Well, they made them serve on the British ship. They made them work hard on the British ship. For 2.5 years, they were made to work on that British ship. And before Joe could even get away, this did happen a long time ago, the War of 1812 happened in the United States. Now, Joe was a U.S. citizen, and he was on a British ship. And so the captain said, you either serve with us and fight your own country, or you're going to be a prisoner of war. Well, Joe said, I am not going to fight against my country. I'm going to be loyal to the United States. And they made him a prisoner of war for another 2.5 years. Finally, after 5 years, Joe got to go home. Now, you would think, after all that, that Joe would give up sailing. What do you think? Nope. He didn't give up sailing. In fact, he went on to be the captain of his own ship. And he sailed all over, making money and doing what he loves, sailing. Well, one time, actually, it was after that 5-year horrible years, you know, Joe got home and he fell in love. Oh, my goodness. He fell in love with a lady named Prudence Nye. In fact, it was an old schoolmate of his. And he was so excited. But guess what? He was still a sailor. And he'd be gone for months at a time. And poor Prudy, he called her Prudy. Her name was Prudence, but he called her Prudy. Poor Prudy had to stay home all by herself and take care of the home. And eventually they had 3 children, and she had to take care of all of them while Joe was out at sea. Well, one time, as Joe was getting ready to leave, Prudy took a Bible and stuck it in Joe's trunk. He didn't know. But when he got on board, he wanted to read something. He opened his trunk, And there was a Bible from Prudy, and he really loved Prudy. And so he said, I think I need to read this. And guess what? Joe fell in love with God. Now he gloried in God, and he had to do the other jobs, but nothing else mattered as much as his friendship with God. And finally, after 21 years, he retired from being a sailor, and guess what he started doing? He started working for God. In fact, he learned about Jesus' second coming. Well, that was exciting. And then he learned that the seventh day was the Sabbath. A lot of people didn't know that. And so he started teaching other people about it. In fact, he even told James and Ellen White about Sabbath being on the seventh day. And he went on to become one of the founders of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, our church. He helped start our church. You know, when Joseph Bates gloried in knowing God, oh, here, let me show you a picture. There's Captain Bates, sea captain turned worker for God, and there's Prudy, that's his wife that he loved very much. But when he gloried in God, guess what? God used him in a powerful way. And it's the same way with us. There's nothing wrong with being smart and strong and talented or even being rich. There's nothing wrong with that as long as it's not the most important thing in our life. Because God knows we will be the happiest when we glory in him. Let's have a little prayer, okay? Can you bow your heads? Dear Jesus, we want to glory in you. We want you to be our best friend. And I hope that each child here chooses you. We love you. In your name, amen.
Happy Sabbath, saints of God. Please stand for the scripture reading. Acts 2, 46 and 47. When you find it, say amen. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. 47, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily as should be saved. Amen.
Solo I ever sang in this church. So please, it's about the time of year, and listen to the words. God has a blessing in this song. Go ahead, drive nails in my head.
laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead, say it is in me. The day will come when you will see, 'cause I'll rise again. There's no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and mark my name, my love for you. Still the same. Go ahead and bury me, but very soon I will be free, because I'll rise again. There's no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead. Say I'm dead and gone, but you will see, you were wrong. Go ahead, try to hide the sun, but all will see.
Amen. Thank you, Tony. Wasn't that beautiful? I enjoyed that song. And I enjoyed the baptism. Wasn't that a beautiful baptism? I see Damien holding his little son over there, Luke. And it's such a beautiful picture of what God has in store for us. Oh, I love the background music. That's nice. Speaking of music, Matthew West in Casting Crowns, I love their song. He says, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your good news. Thank you that you're coming back to take us home soon. And we pray that we won't get ready, that we'll be ready, and that we'll stay ready. in a connection and a close walk with you. I just pray again that you'll just make me a simple nail on a wall and hang a beautiful shining picture of your son's face in his place. Ask this in Jesus' precious name and for his sake. Amen. A recent study shows that half the people on this planet, how many? Half the people on this planet, that's right, half the people on this planet make up 50% of the world's population. Study it out, do the math. And you and I are one of them. Imagine that. We're one of those people. That's why I love Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5, and it says, I knew you. I knew you. I knew all of you before you were even born. Listen to the verse here in Philippians, in Galatians chapter 1 and verse 15. It says, even before I was born, even before I was born, God chose me and called me by his marvelous grace, and it pleased him. You see, that is the purpose that you and I have, is to please God. It's all about his glory and not ours, amen? It's all about the glory of Jesus Christ. Now, they say, and I just read this study, Medical Sciences, that the chances of you being born in your parents' meeting was 1 in 500 million billion that you even exist. Isn't that amazing? But see, God knew ahead of time. But one thing that your parents didn't do, I'm pretty certain, they didn't ask you if you'd like to get born. It just happened. But what if God came to you and said, how would you like to be born on that planet? You mean that one, Lord? You mean the one with sickness and sadness and heartache and pain and death? Are there any other choices? I think I'd rather go to that one instead, right? But see, God never gave you and I a chance. And it almost seems unfair until you begin to understand the great sacrifice God made for each and every one of us. He sent his one and only son, the most famous verse in all of Scripture. God, what, loved the church? No, loved his, no, he so loved the world. He so loved the world that he gave his only son. Now, if any father, I mean, if God loved us so much, why didn't he come down himself? Well, any father knows it would be much harder to send his son than to go himself, right? I mean, if there was a war going on, said, hey, if you just send our son, we could do whatever we want with him, and then we'll end the war. I don't know if I'd do it. I don't think I could send my son. I don't know what they'd do to him. And look at what we did to Jesus. He lived among us, and he was killed by his own human creation, by his the creation of his hand. Those are the people who killed him, and imagine that. But here's the amazing thing. You and I, because of Jesus taking on humanity, we have a closer connection than any other creation in the universe. You and I have this connection with Jesus. And maybe some of you have that already, because you don't have to wait to get to heaven to have that connection. Did you know that? It's all about this wonderful gift that Jesus has given to each and every one of us every day of saying, hey, listen, would you just come? I'm knocking at the door here. I'm not going to kick it down, Revelation 3:20, and I'm going to just stand there until you open that door. That still small voice is, I'd love to come and have a meal with you, and I'd love to talk to you. I'd just like to be in your presence and you be in mine. And that's what Jesus invites us to do every day. So we start out every day with a positive attitude and a grateful heart and the courage to move forward with what is right, to do what is right, and to make a difference. And to make a difference. In fact, other words, go mad. Go make a difference. And when you do, there's nothing standing between you and outrageous success other than continuous progress, moving forward. And when you go that extra mile, God, by the way, there are no traffic jams on the extra mile. You just keep moving, and God will direct you. You just keep your eyes on him, and he will guide you as to what you should do. Brian Tracy wrote a book. It's called Goals. I've read it 3 times. It's one of the best books I've read. And in there, he gives this little illustration. If you take a pigeon, you put him in a box, cage, put a blanket over it or covering over it, give them some food and water, and you travel 2,000, 5,000 miles, doesn't matter how far, any direction, north, south, east, west, and then you take the cover off, you release this pigeon, guess what? He'll go up in the air, he'll circle 2-3 times, and he'll go right back home. Because he has this GPS system in his that God had connected him with, he'll go right back home. Did you know the only other creation in the world are human beings? You and I have a GPS. We were not made for this world alone. There's something a whole lot better. And when you feel that emptiness inside and that wonder, well, is this all there is? It's because you and I were created for something more. Amen. You and I were created for something a whole lot more. Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither is it into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for those who love him. Do you love him today? Oh, yes, you do. And you want to be with him. I can imagine when we get to heaven, just imagine with me for just a moment, we get to heaven and Jesus opens the door of, you know, that wonderful mansion in John 14. He says, my Father's house, there are many rooms. And he says, he opens the door and there is your favorite meal. What's your favorite meal? Italian, Mexican? I don't know. And there it is. Mangoes, you know, whatever it is, a mango smoothie. Jesus has already figured out just what you need. He's already preparing. I'm preparing a place for you. And think about it. Jesus has prepared a place for you. Now, when God gives us an assignment, he also gives us the ability to accomplish it, right? Now, he gives us a lamp unto our feet, not a crystal ball into the future. None of us knows our future, right? I mean, if we did, we probably wouldn't like it, some of it. But we know what ends. Someone gave me a hat. I love this hat. I know how it all ends. God wins. God wins in the end. And I want to be on the winning side too, don't you? I want to be on the winning side because God will always win. And his plan is always more beautiful than our desires. God is looking for a servant's heart. He really is. And if you don't have room in your heart for others, maybe it's just because you're so full of yourself. Ouch. Now, I'm not an astronomer, but my dad used to say, I'm not an astronomer, son, but I'm pretty sure that the earth goes around the sun, revolves around the sun, and not you. And he says, don't worry about what others think about you. They're probably thinking about themselves anyway. In fact, they did a study. Most of the time, people are thinking about themselves. Me, myself, and selfie, you know. In fact, they did a study on teens. They asked some questions. They were honest. 27 to 30 times every day, they do selfies. All right, do the math. I don't know what that adds up to, a week, a year, a day, but every year. But someone said, and we become very self-centered. We become narcissists. As someone asked me a question the other day. Said, how many narcissists does it take to change a light bulb? None, because they use gaslighting. Now, do you know what gaslighting is? It's an insidious form of manipulation and psychological control. Zig Ziglar tells this story, and this is how we can't just be an island of self-centered, but we need to be reaching out, and we do so much more when we work together. And this is why we're talking about life groups throughout this series and doing life together. And Zig Ziglar tells this story of this guy. He's from New York, and he's an insurance agent, and he goes out to some of these farmers, and he gets to a wrong turn, and he tries to turn back, and he gets stuck in a ditch. So he goes, knocks on a farmer's door, and the old farmer, he says, I'll get old Betsy. And Betsy's old, but she can pull you out. And so he takes old Betsy, picks up the rope, and he says, come on, Clifford. Come on, Elmer. Come on, Frankie. And then he says, come on, Betsy. And Betsy just, with no effort, just pulls that car out. And the New Yorker says, I noticed that you have four different names for your horse. Why is that? He says, old Betsy's blind. And if she thought she was doing it all by herself, she could never have done it. You see, when we do things together, there's so much more. Are you aware that a horse pulling bicep can pull 8,000 pounds. Guess what it can do with one other horse that's properly changed? Not 16, not 24, but 32,000 pounds, quadruples, because they do it together. Do you know that geese, they fly in a V formation? We've all seen that, right? Because it helps them. And there's something else, too, that I was reading. And you ever hear of David Attenborough, you know? And he was saying that there's leadership, so they trade. And so the younger ones come up to the front. And there's just amazing thing. And there's this V formation. And there's always one side that's a little longer. Do you know why? There's a scientific reason. There's more geese on one side. Just thought you'd know. But we do things, we can go further. There's an old African proverb, you want to go fast, go alone. You want to go further, go together. And so when we go together, so much more can be accomplished by going together and doing things together. And when we do things by ourselves, sometimes we get ourselves in trouble. And sometimes we make mistakes. A pastor, a friend of mine, his name is Joseph, he tells this story on himself. I'm not sure it's true, but he told it. And he says he's at the airport. Now, as he's at the airport, he has a little time. And so he goes and he buys some cookies. He buys two famous Amos chocolate chip cookies. But there's a deal going on that day. You buy two, you get one free. So he puts them in a bag and he goes to find his spot where he's going to sit close to where he's boarding. He puts his coat and his bag of cookies there because he sees the Wall Street Journal. Someone left it. He goes over to get it, and when he comes back, there's this guy sitting in his seat. And he says he kind of looks like a hippie. He's got long hair. He's kind of, you know, he's clean and neat, but he's kind of in his own world, and he's eating my bag of cookies. He said, I know him in there. What's mine is yours, what's yours is mine, but he's eating my bag of cookies. And he said, I sat beside him, and I thought, you know what? You're not going to eat all my cookies. And he said, remember, there was three in there, so he just reached in, and he grabbed one, and he glared at the hippie guy, and the hippie guy just smiled at him like, big deal, you know. And so he eats his cookie, and the hippie guy is done with his cookie, so he grabs for the last one. And Joe said, I'm not done, but I'm not going to let him have that last cookie. So he grabs his hand, and they kind of like wrestle for that last cookie. And he says, I broke it off, and I got the bigger half, but still I was mad. And so he eats his cookie, and after a while, the hippie guy just smiles and walks off. Finally, his flight is called, and he grabs his coat, and under his coat is his bag of cookies. He said, I felt about this small. He said, and here I am, a pastor. And he says, you know, here's this hippie guy was more Christ-like than I was. Never assume. And he said, it taught me such a great lesson, wherever I am, not to assume the worst in anyone. There's so much good in others, so much good. Now, we're not saved by our works, but our works reveal whether or not we're saved in a saving relationship with the one who saved us. And here's the good news. God uses people who fail, because that's the only kind there are. Amen? And I want you to know that my wife could tell you a lot of stories about, well, don't ask her. A lot of things that I have done that have failed. Our spouses could tell a lot on us, right? But the good news is that Jesus forgives and we can keep moving forward. A pilot once said that whenever you're about to land, never look where you're not going to land, only land on what you're going to land. And Paul knew that. He always landed on Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, he talks about how I came in fear and weakness and much trembling. And he said, I didn't come with enticing words of man's wisdom, but I was determined to do one thing, and that was to talk about Jesus. Now, he talked about meat offered to idols. He talked about all different kinds of things, women in church. He talked about this and that, but he always landed on Jesus. And that's what we've got to do. We've got to make certain that Jesus is the meal. You know, someone said that you need to put Jesus in everything, like he's a side salad or an hors d'oeuvre. No, Jesus is everything. I said it once before, my dad always remembered, the main thing is to keep the main thing, and that is Jesus, not us. It's always been him. And when we do that, we know that when we put on Christ, my mom used to tell me as I'd go to school, she says, don't worry about what you're wearing. That smile goes with anything. And so that smile, that joy that we have in Christ exudes, it just comes out because we have this love relationship with our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. So it's all about relationships. One of my favorite stories, well, Jesus is telling his disciples these words. He says, I'm giving you a new commandment. Love each other. Now, this is nothing new. It's in the Old Testament. It's in Deuteronomy. It's in Leviticus. And he says, love each other just as I have loved you. Now he gives them an example. The way I loved you, I want you to love others. You should love each other. And then he says, your love for one another will what? Prove to the world you're my disciples. It's not about the Sabbath. That's good. It's not about what we eat or don't eat. Okay, that's important. Sure. It's about your love for one another. Amen. So one of my favorite stories is in Mark chapter 2. I'm going to follow along as you will. When Jesus returned from Capernaum, several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. He's back home again. And then it says, soon the house where he was staying was so packed with visitors that there was no room even outside the door. In fact, I just got a text, says there's no room to park. And that's a good problem, but a bad problem, right? They did a study, Rick Warren and Andy Stanton did a study, and they found out that, I'm going to just kind of tell on you, the older generation, if they see there's no parking spot, it's too crowded, they may not stay or not come back the next week. And they say 80% or more, and if it's full. But the younger generation, guess this, if they see it's packed and there's no room, they say, well, that's the place I want to be. It's kind of like a restaurant. You know, that's a good place to eat. So keep coming back. Sorry there was no parking spots. We're in discussion about what we're going to do about that. But that's a good problem, but we don't want to miss anyone. We don't want to miss anyone. So packed. They're all packed. So what happens? While he was preaching God's word to them, four men. How many? Four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. They couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd. Let me just push the pause button. Don't be that person that keeps someone from Jesus, all right? So they dug a hole through the roof above his head, and then they lowered the man on his mat right in front of Jesus. You know what these guys did? They were determined to get their friend to Jesus. They saw the crowd. They said, you know what? There's no way we're going to get through that crowd. They go up on the roof. Can you see them there? And they're trying to pull up their friend on this mat, trying not to make him, you know, tilt. And they finally get, they tear up the roof. Here's actually a picture. I thought I had a picture, but I don't. Maybe I do later. And so they tear up the roof, and they lower him right in front of Jesus. Can you see? I wish I was there. Do you realize that this story, this gospel story, is so important because that's our job? Our job is to bring people to Jesus. Who's holding your ropes? Who's holding your ropes? I have people that will tell me back in my last church, you know, I didn't do this, I missed that, or they have these problems, or they're in the hospital, and no one knew. And sometimes the pastor is the last one to know. Everyone thinks I know, and I don't even know. But if you're in a life group, I tell them, if you're in a life group, those people are going to surround you. They're going to be with you. In fact, I just had a guy named Michael. Michael called me up the other day. Hey, Pastor, I noticed that your house, you know, it hasn't sold, of course. So I'm going to come and feed you. I have koi fish. I'm going to feed your koi fish for you every day. He's going to come up there and just volunteer, part of my life group. They'll look out after you, these life group people. By the way, just kind of trivia here. Anyone know how long a koi fish can live, Japanese koi fish? Over 100 years. There's one in China, they claim it's 240-some years old right now. One sold for $1.8 million, just one koi, $1.8 million in Japan. Well, I just gave that out for free, so I'm digressing. So seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, my child, your sins are forgiven. This is so important. But some of the teachers of the religious law were sitting there, thought to themselves, what is he saying? This is blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins. Amen? Only God forgives sins. I'm going to come back to that. So here's the hole in the roof. Can you imagine that? There they, because there was boards and there was mud and then there was all kinds of things. But they made it through. Jesus knew immediately what they were thinking. Jesus knows what we're thinking. So he asked them, why do you question this in your hearts? Is it easier to say to the paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or stand up and pick up your mat and walk? So I will prove, he uses that word again, I will prove to you that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins. Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, but let me go back, Jesus forgives sins. I used to hear preachers say this all the time. Jesus laid down his God-given divinity, right? When he came here, he gave up, he laid aside his divinity. He never used his divinity. I used to say that too, but he didn't. He used it for one purpose, and that's to forgive. And that's what they were so upset about, that Jesus now is claiming to be God, because only God can forgive sins, amen? And Jesus forgave, and he forgives all of us. And then he says, stand up and pick up your mat and go home. And the man jumped up and grabbed his mat and walked out through the stunned crowd. And they were all amazed and praised God and exclaimed, we've never seen anything like this before. Nothing like this before. I love that story because you know what? Jesus is inviting us to bring others into his presence. And when we bring others, guess what? We keep coming back to Jesus too. We get to see the thrill and the joy of someone else coming to Jesus. I just loved the testimony of Damien today. And to hear that and to see that. I was just finished preaching at Hamilton Church and I was talking to people up front and shaking their hands and this couple. I remember this couple. He was wearing a black suit. It's so out of common with Hamilton because I actually preached in jeans and just a shirt back there. But they came up, and he's wearing a black suit with black bow tie and just looked sharp, like they was going to some, you know, evening presidential ball. And she's wearing a bright red dress. He says, can we talk to you? I said, sure. So we sat down, and he says, you know, he says, my wife and I, this morning, we went to the church that we're members of, and before we could even get in the door, my wife was told she was not allowed in, that she'd have to go home and change first because she was wearing a red dress. Of course, my wife began to weep and to cry. We walked down the steps. We got in the car, and I couldn't console her, and I said, honey, let's go to Hamilton. They'll let anyone in there. And we have. I remember there's one guy with spiked hair and piercings all over. I mean, it looked like he just rolled out of a fishing tackle box. I mean, it's just tattoos. And I he told me one time, he said, he came up, Pastor, man, this just loving all over me. I can't stop it. And so it didn't matter what you looked like to come to Hamilton. And I see that at this church, too. But anyways, this lady and her husband said, you know, Three times, ladies came up to me and said, oh, I just love your beautiful red dress. And she said, it made me feel so good. And then he looked at me and he says, I filled out one of those cards. He said, I'm not an impulse buyer or anything like that, but I am sold on being here. I'm going to let them know I'm no longer coming to that church and I'm going to be here. You know what? Over time, they became our head greeters. And just did a marvelous job. And they started a life group and was one of the most exciting, exhilarating life groups and such wonderful, dear people. Another guy, right after them, I'll just call him Brent. Brent came and said, hey, you know what? I just came with my girlfriend today. I've never really talked to a pastor, but I just felt impressed to come up and talk to you. And I said, well, what are you doing? He was an outdoorsy kind of guy. And so we decided to go mountain biking. So we got on a mountain bikes and we were talking, and so we started running together, and over time, we started a life group together and other runners, but mostly he and I. And so one day he says, hey, this time is going on. It looked like he lived out of his car, but he did have an apartment. He looked like he was lived in a cave, really. He was kind of that outdoorsy kind of guy. And I thought, he just doesn't have anything, you know. About a year after we've been running together, he says, "Hey, Pastor," he says, "wait right here, I want to give you something." And he writes me a check. He said, "You know," he says, "you probably don't realize this, but every time we run," he says, "you're always talking about your friend Jesus and how much he means to you. We always have a Bible study." He says, "you've led me to Christ, and I just love coming to your church and being a part of that." And he wrote me a check, and guess how much it was? $20,000. I looked at that check and says, "Is this for me or for the church?" I gave it to the church. Then he wrote another one a few months later, another one, $20,000, you know. He bought 176 acres on Signal Mountain. I mean, there's this kid who had nothing. He started investing in real estate, became very, very wealthy. Now, guess where he lives? He lives in Colorado. He bought a lot of acreage here. He moved over here, and I said, "I might be joining you," and I did. But he's a little ways away. But just being friendly to people, opening our hearts to them. You know, Paul, he began to understand Paul the Apostle. If you read Acts chapter 9, just real quickly, he's on the Damascus Road, blinded by a bright light, and he says, "Why are you persecuting me, Paul?" He says, "Who are you?" "I'm Jesus, who you're persecuting." Paul's conversion, scales off his eyes. "Ananias, go tell Paul on Straight Street. And baptize him." He says, "That guy, I mean, he persecuted Christians." He says, why him?" He says, "Because he's going to do something you would not. He's going to share the gospel with the Gentiles and Samaritans and people you decided not to." And so Paul now, he gets baptized. And didn't he go through the 27 fundamental beliefs? Didn't he go through the dog? Didn't he? Paul was baptized, and then he began to preach boldly. In fact, he was preaching so boldly now, guess what? They wanted to murder him. He was in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, and they wanted to beat him, and they drag him out of the city, and then he'd come back the next day. "We thought we killed you." "Yeah, but I hadn't finished my sermon yet," so he just kept going. And then Paul was being, they wanted to kill him. They were really this time, and so his friends, guess what? They lower him in a basket. Who's holding your ropes? Who's holding your ropes? Paul, 84 times, we find that the apostles, they gathered together in homes 84 times just in the book of Acts because they knew that life was there. They spent more time in homes than they did at the church. They did. And so Paul, if you go to 1 Corinthians, he's talking about how one day, as this time goes on, he says, and I'll show you the passage of Scripture here. This is amazing. He says, 14 years ago, I was caught up in the third heaven. That caught my attention. I just thought, man, I got to share this with you. He says, 14 years ago, I was caught up in the third heaven. You know, sometimes we read verses a lot, and then we think, wow, how did I miss that? I mean, I've read this many, many times. I heard things so astounding that they cannot be expressed in words, so I'm not going to tell you about them. What? You were caught in the third heaven 14 years ago, and now he's going to tell us that he's not going to tell us. The only thing he's going to tell us is that he's not going to tell us. Just a moment of transparency about this, Pastor. I got this from Kyle Eidelman. But if I were caught up in the third heaven, you'd be hearing about it the next Sabbath. All right? I mean, it would be, I would get on social media. I would get on every social media, you know, Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp, Instagram, YouTube, Snapchat, WeChat, TikTok, Telegram, Pinterest, Q, Rabbit. I mean, I would get on everything hashed in the third heaven. I mean, I would write a book. I would write a book, you know, how I was caught up in the third heaven, why God chose me and not you. I mean, I would every time I was invited to speak, you know, I'd write this book and I'd be invited to speak at other places. And, you know, my bio would be, here's Dave from the third heaven. And but Paul, all he says is, I'm not going to tell anyone about it. Isn't that amazing? You know what he says next? You can read it. He says, I am a slave, I am a servant of Jesus Christ. Why does he say that? Because it's all about him, and he says, what is a slave known for? Their master. It's not their pedigree, it's not their heritage, it's all about their master. And Paul says, I just want you to know about Jesus, amen? I just want you to know about him, just so you don't get any confusion. What is the third heaven? You see, we here on this earth, there's an atmosphere, and then there's the stars and the galaxies, and then there's the heaven where he was caught up. I believe to the very paradise where you and I will return one day to heaven. When I was, well, let me share this. This is from Harvard University. What distinguishes less happy people from flourishing, I love that word, flourishing happy people, is not their money, it's not your health, security, attractiveness, IQ, or career success. I should read that again. Hope you got that. We found out what distinguishes consistently happier people from less happy people is the presence of rich, deep, joy-producing, life-changing, meaningful relationships. Isn't that beautiful? It's about relationships, and that's what life groups create, are relationships. That's what it makes. So, I'm at 18 St. Charles Place in Peachtree City. This is my church about 20-some years ago. And we just created some life groups, Rick Warren's book, 40 Days of Purpose, and we had 21 life groups going on. And my group, we were trying to reach our neighbors. We said, hey, one of the goals we have is reach our neighbors. And I knew all my neighbors except for this one. He just moved in, and I asked him if I could help him move in. No, I got it. And he had a friend. And I had always tried to, you know, connect with him, and he was a contractor. He was always busy, you know. And so I thought, man, how am I going to connect with this guy? I just never did. So on New Year's Day, this is my last story. On New Year's Day, I put on my tool belt. My wife can tell you. I put on my tool belt and said, honey, I'm going to remodel our master bathroom. She said, well, you've never done that. Well, I've got YouTube. I didn't know what I was doing. I took a skill saw, and I thought, there's a fiberglass insert shower, and I just started cutting. And as I'm cutting, water just came out like this. Oh, man, I didn't realize how much water can come out of a little pipe like that. And it's just flooding everywhere. And I'm just over there, and I've tried to pull open, and I'm putting duct tape around it. That's not working. And it's just bursting. And I go down. I know there's some kind of a thing at the sidewalk where you can turn it off. And I see this one, and I turn it, and it's an irrigation valve. And it just goes like Old Faithful. It's just like everyone. It just hits me in the face. And I can't find the other one. So I run, and I thought, my contractor neighbor. And I just go, and I knock on his door real quick. And I thought, oh, no, I hope he didn't hear because, you know, it's New Year's Day. I'm sure they stayed up late and, you know, and watched the ball or whatever. And so I thought, oh, so I ran back in, and water just coming. My wife, Debbie, she's putting towels there because now it's building up. And she puts towels and blankets, and the bathroom is upstairs, unfortunately. And we're just trying to stop this. 15 minutes goes by, 20 minutes goes by. I panic. So I call 911. The lady, so nice, is, you know, she says, there's an officer not far from you, and I'll just send him. He was there in 5 minutes. He gets out of his car, and I remember, I kid you not, he gets out of his car, and he just crosses his arm, because now it is just flowing through all of our vents and everything, and it's coming down through our garage like Niagara Falls, because it had been building up. It's just like Niagara Falls, just flowing down. And I still had a lot of stuff we hadn't unpacked in boxes, and he crosses his arms, and he says, I don't know what to do. But do you mind if I watch this for a while? I'm like, a lot of help you are, you know. Get out of here. So I call a plumber in my church, Johnny Miller. I said, and he lives about 4 miles from me. I said, Johnny, what do I do? You're a plumber. And he tries to help. I didn't know what to do. But he said, I'm on my way. But the contractor, he did hear my honk, my knock. And he comes out, and he fishes in there. He turns that one off, and he turns the other one off. Now, 30-some minutes, water has been just plowing through our house, just going through all the ductwork and everything. And so he goes in, and the drywall on the ceiling is like this. And he and the water just, he gets a bunch of 5-gallon Home Depot buckets, and so it starts running in there. And of course, we got to call the Serve Pro, and everything is, I mean, it's just a disaster. And it's a fairly new house, and we've only lived in there about a year. And so, anyways, my neighbor, who I could never help, stayed all day and helped me clean up. He stayed till the sun went down. I kid you not. He stayed till the late evening and helped me. And I remember watching him work from a distance, and he was just cleaning, he was vacuuming with a shop vac, and just making certain everything, all the boxes in my garage, he just stayed all day. And I remember thinking, you know what, he wouldn't let me help him, but he helped me. And sometimes the only way you and I will reach people is not by us helping them, but by asking them, could you help me? Could you do this for me? And I'm asking you, would you do something for him, not for me? Would you be a part of a life group? What will be one of the best things you ever do for yourself? It will, I guarantee. In fact, my wife sent some pictures in to, this is what it looked like before. And she sent, you ever hear of this old house? So my wife sent some pictures into this old house, and this is what it looked like, and I was gonna, that's what it looked like afterwards. And this is what the bathroom looked like, and that's, and then I did a few other things. I built a big old koi pond back there. So that's the koi pond, and did a few other things back there. So, and plus it won the Moxie Award. It won an award in there, but I remember thinking about all the things that have transpired through our life groups. And it reminded me of one story that I'm going to close with, a very short story. There's a soldier outside the White House, and he's crying. A little lad, a boy, sees the man crying. He says, sir, why are you crying? He says, I wanted to see the president, but there's no way I will. And the little boy says, will you come with me? He takes his hand, and he walks right by the guard. The guard doesn't stop him. He walks across the grass of the White House leading up to the front steps. No one stops. No one says anything. He goes into the foyer, and there in the foyer, no one says anything to the lad or the soldier, and he walks right into the Oval Office of the president, and he says, Dad, this man wants to see you, and Abraham Lincoln, true story, reaches out his hand and shakes the young soldier's hand. Do you realize, like that, Jesus will take your hand and take you to the very throne room of the Father. He says, Dad, Father, this man wants to see you. This woman wants to see you. This young person wants to see you. Jesus has the authority to the very throne room, and every time we pray, he takes us right there. Prayer is not just a necessity, it's a luxury. And it's also, we come to the very grace and to the throne room of God each time we do. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word and for the passion that you have given to each and every one of us to be a part of something bigger. And as we hear just a short little testimony as we close, I just pray that your spirit will guide us and keep us close to you, and may we all be a part of a life group. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Dwayne, come right up here for just a moment. Dwayne, are you here? I asked Dwayne, just before we walk out, this is intentional because I'm going to invite you to sign up for a life group. We have four tables. There's people that are going to be out there, and there's three different, well, actually four, but one of them is you can just sign up for a life group. You can say, I'll be a leader of a life group. I would like to be a host. I'll open my home, or I could bring refreshments. Tell us about the life group you're in. Come on up here so they can all see you.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. So let me start by saying, I have not been the same since I joined the life group.
Amen.
I'm a part of so many life groups here. Monday nights, I'm at the upper room with my prayer warriors. Wednesday night, I'm at Bible study. And Friday nights, I'm every other Friday night, I'm with the young adults for Vespers. The reason why I love the young adult group is there's so many benefits. You get to dive into the Word together, right? You get to fellowship. You get that spiritual food, followed by the physical food, which is very important. we also go out to community outreach. We go out and feed the homeless, which we're doing today. And anyone, you're free to join us after church. Then we also have clean fun, right? Because Christians can have fun too. I'm thinking about putting it on a shirt. It sounds cool. We get to, last time we went to whirly ball, bowling, we have game nights, you know, and we have great times when we meet up. And also, if you're going through things, say, sickness or you need a job, we are there with you, right? We are together, right? So we go through it together. So I have a question. If someone was sitting beside you right now and they said, I just started going back to church. I love what the church is doing, but I need to be in a small group so I can open up. But the only requirement they have is that you are a part of that group. Would you be able to invite that person to a group that you're a part of? Mm. Join a life group today. It will change your life. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you. Let's give him a hand. Appreciate that. Gail, could you bring that up? And I want to invite Damien to come. And would you, Crystal and Luke, would you come up too, please? I'd love for them to meet little Luke. Just come right up here. We want to say how excited we are, Damien, that you made this decision. And you and I have talked that this is a transition time in your life. You've rededicated your life to the Lord, to your wife, and to your little one. And I just want to offer a prayer of blessing on your life. Lord, we thank you for Damien and Crystal and little Luke, and I just pray that you'll guide and direct them. Keep them close to you as little Luke will be dedicated very soon. We're just so grateful for this family and what you have in store for them, how they've opened their home many times to the young adults and been a blessing to so many. Bless them, I pray, and may we all together work together in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless you. And I want to thank you all for coming. As you go out, be sure and sign up for one of the life groups. This is only the beginning. We'll let you know when they start, but be a part of a life group today. Thank you, and may God bless you all real good. Hey, can I get
pictures with you?
Absolutely. Come on over.